This morning, I just want to remind you of some things that are stirring to me, and I pray that they would be stirring to you. Father, let your word find root within our heart, disciple, bless, and encourage us, as well as challenge us to be more like Jesus, we pray in your holy name. There is but one life giver in all the universe, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Scripture repeats over and over that it is, of course, the Lord God Almighty who breathes life into all things that we would consider to have life. Even some things that are a bit, in a sense, confusing, in the sense that Jesus said, if I was to cause these to be quiet, even the rocks would cry out. Okay, so I don't understand that. One day, perhaps I will. In Scripture, we discover that the trees are clapping their hands. We discover that the insects and all creation in Romans 7 is yearning for the Lord Jesus to come and set up his throne upon this earth. John chapter 1, verse 3 says, all things come into being through him, and that him is the subject of the Gospel of John. It is Jesus. And apart from Jesus, not one thing came into being that has come into being. All things came through Jesus. Hebrews 11, verse 3, by faith we understand the worlds were created by the word of God in order that what is seen did not come into existence from what is visible. He called into existence those things which formerly did not exist. Who is like our God? Psalm 33, verse 6, by the word of Yahweh the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth all of their host. Isaiah 40, verse 26, lift your eyes up on high and see who created these. The one who brings out their host by number, who calls them by name, because he is great of power, mighty of power, not one is missing. I love looking through the heavens early in the morning when I'm taking my doggy out in the backyard, or at night in camping. One of the great pleasures of camping is to look at the heavens above and wonder two things: how great thou art, and how great I ain't. Amen. One of the things that Scripture goes thoroughly through in its subject is to profess to those that will read, study, ponder, meditate, and take part of their life, is that our God loves his creation. He loves you. We will be coming soon in Matthew chapter 6 and verse 26 in our Sunday morning sermons to the place where Jesus says to those sitting upon the hill, consider the birds of the sky, that they do not sow or reap or gather, produce into barns, and your heavenly Father feeds them. And he asks the question of those listening. He asks of you this morning, are you not more valuable than they? To the Lord God, you are valuable above all things. This is why I have loved saying every year that there is no such thing as illegitimate children. There is no such thing as illegitimate children. I still have, as a very dear friend of mine, lives down in La Jolla with my sister, or near my sister, a girl who at the age of 16 in high school in the 60s was sent to a reform school for pregnant girls. She was not allowed, even after her junior year, giving birth to a beautiful child, just a beautiful child, she was not allowed to return to school even as a senior simply because she was a girl that had a child out of wedlock, in the sense that her sin invaded everything that she was. And I would ponder, I would guess that there is a mindset, not only of those in the 60s, perhaps even a mindset today, that God is somehow out of control in the sexual acts of people in this world. That God's surprised by the result of a sexual act becoming a child, and that somehow he's forced in that conception to breathe life into that. But I would say your God is not my God, if that's what you believe. My God is in control of all things. He husbands, as it were, even the orbits of electrons. In the infinitesimally small to the infinitesimally great, my God is in control of all things. Is he in control of all the things that you do? He would like to be, but in fact, he allows us the free moral choice to make decisions that are apart from what he would will for you to do. And though it's a surprise to young or old who become pregnant out of wedlock, out of the covenant of God, that something has happened that they couldn't control, they take the step then to come into control of something that God has done, though they presume it's something that they have done. I've spoken with many, many couples in premarital counseling that would admit readily that they had sex prior to their covenant with God. Okay, but God is still God. And when it comes to an event in your life when God is allowed, as it were, to breathe life into your womb, we give glory to God, not to planning our parenthood. You get the association there. There was a day in the Gospels of Matthew and John when Herod, so-called the Great, had decided that his throne was above all thrones. And there's been men in history past, biblical history, and extra-biblical history, that have presumed within their hearts that they are greater than God. We, of course, reflect upon the outcome of Nebuchadnezzar's life in Daniel chapter 4 when he was told very specifically that God hears your heart with respect to your kingdom and the things that you believe that you have built, and rather were the construct of a loving God who in your midst brought a young man who spoke into your life in Daniel 2:22, that there is a God in heaven that knows all secrets and there's nothing mysterious to him. And Nebuchadnezzar, the dream that you had is this. And this is what God is saying to you. And through the course of three chapters of Daniel, Daniel continues to speak into Nebuchadnezzar's life about a God most powerful, a God most knowing, a God that had a plan for all of humanity and will not be discouraged or waylaid or detoured by the plans of man. And so by Daniel chapter 4, Nebuchadnezzar, standing on the rooftop of his monumentous kingdom, but that was, by the way, one of the seven wonders of the world, the gardens of Babylon. He said, Nebuchadnezzar, you will chew from the cud for 7 years. You will wander with dew upon your back until you are prepared to give glory to God. So the day came when Nebuchadnezzar indeed gave glory to God, and he stood once again upon the rooftop of his mansions and declared that there is but one God in all heaven and earth, and that is the God of Israel. And that God had determined through this little 12-year-old boy who was brought to the Chaldean nation against his will. But God had a will against Daniel's will. And God proved through Daniel that, in fact, God is not finished with the nations of this earth even to our day. With prophetic words that still profoundly affect us even this morning. And we pondered the 12th chapter of Daniel. And we wonder, Lord God, how long? In Matthew, great Herod presumed that he could protect his human throne by making sure that a deliverer that was professed and acclaimed to the shepherds of the fields by angelic hosts that were proclaimed and professed that might by magi who wandered hundreds of miles from this same city, Babylon, and asked Herod, where is this child? And Herod said, I know not. Until those that had some semblance of understanding concerning the scriptures told those wise men, go to Bethlehem. By the time the wise men arrive in Bethlehem, Jesus is around 2 years old. And this is why Herod had determined, because the wise men refused to go back to Jerusalem to tell Herod where this child exactly was, that it says that Herod became angry. Matthew chapter 2, verse 13 says, now after they had gone away, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared. The Magi had gone away, appeared in a dream to Joseph and said, get up, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and stay there until I tell you. For Herod is about to seek the child to destroy him. I want you to know that the devil's plan as a deceiver is also to destroy. With respect to the word destroyer, there isn't any more ancient term that resides upon the being Lucifer. And though there are many minions in the unseen realm, and though there are many Satans in the unseen realm, and though it would be a presumption of yours to suppose that Lucifer is the king of them, there is no king to the locusts that consume the earth. There is no king to the tornadoes that wreak havoc upon this earth. There is no demigod that indeed can force you to do something that is against God's will. It ends up being our choice. He said, get up. It wasn't a burning bush. It wasn't the heralds of angels speaking to the shepherds. It wasn't a donkey that stopped Balaam. Wasn't a trumpet that proclaimed the Lord's will from the heavens above. It was a dream. And to Joseph, dreams were credible. To Joseph, dreams meant something that God was intending to profoundly impress him with. And what was most impressive? Save the child and his mother. And so I wouldn't guess it was 8 a.m. after heading to Kay's Country Kitchen for breakfast. Sometime in the night, the dream came and Joseph responded. When God speaks to his children, do his children always respond? Not necessarily so. I'm living proof that God has immense grace and profound mercy. And does he give up with us when he tells us his will and we decide not to respond to it? No, of course he does not. But never confuse God's forbearance with his will. Never confuse the fact that God likes what you're doing simply because he hasn't hit you with a strike of lightning. Yes, God is graceful. God is merciful. But to the churches of Galatia, the Holy Spirit made sure that Paul told them and that we would have this for perpetuity, that God will be not mocked, that whatsoever a man soweth to his flesh, from his flesh he shall reap corruption. But whatsoever a man soweth to his spirit reaps eternal life. Every farmer knows like kind comes from like planting. He doesn't plant corn and get a watermelon. He's expecting to plant corn and get corn. Out of a singular, get multitude. So is life. It is always possible for us to God, for God to change, as it were, the eternal outcome of what we sow. I want you to know that. You may be sitting here this morning and wondering if perhaps as you woke, why morning sickness after what we did last night? I'm concerned. You may be, as a parent, concerned about your daughter not coming home last night, or your son professing things that vex your heart, and you wonder, how is it that Johnny became this way? Sorry, Johnny. But parents often wonder, how is it that my child has become this being who's no longer concerned with the will of God, which we raised him or her with? Yes, good Christian girls are capable of sin. Good Christian boys can make decisions out of what their flesh desires that their spirit is vexed with. And you would think that perhaps God would be finished with you. Oh, but God perhaps is starting something that will confound the non-Christians for decades to come. If you, against the will of the world, would say to God, whatsoever God hath wrought, I will partake in. David wondered about this in Psalm 139 when he said, in sin was I so conceived. But it's not there that his communion with God ends, but rather he ponders over and over how it is that he cannot escape from the viewpoint of a loving God that wants to search and to find and to bless him. And so also does he you. Have you sinned? Yes, Scripture tells us that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But what's the good news? That God has come to send his Son, that by the shedding of his blood, you can be forgiven. And by the way, justified in that God now treats you as though you never committed that sin. You see, the very promise of love, the very definition of love in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 is that love keeps no record of wrongdoing. Praise God that when we have confessed our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. How is that possible? A girl sat in my office and said, Pastor Paul, that's not possible. You're preaching a false gospel. And I said, okay, let's look to the Greek. Let's look to the original language. In the Greek, all means. She had no response. You see, the power of Jesus' blood confounds the world, which finds great trouble in forgiving and forgetting. But we're taught to pray, aren't we not? Forgive us our sins as we forgive the sins of others. Are we not taught to pray by Jesus himself? And we're coming to this in Matthew 6 soon. Are we not taught that in the very quality and quantity that we forgive others, so also God is looking to forgive us? I love the Lord. I love his grace. I love his forbearance. But I will never misinterpret that as him stamping his approval on my sin simply because he hasn't squashed me like a stink bug on the highway of life. Have you given him reason? Oh, Lord Jesus. Have we not all? Have we not all? And yet the crooked finger still is pointed against those that in some pharisaical, frozen, chosen manner wants to point out the sins of others while excusing the sins of our own life. Where's the church been? Where's the church been in perpetuity when a girl was found pregnant? Instead of expelling her from school and sending her to reform school where she could not even visit her parents, the church embracing her and saying, What the world is determined to do, we will not do. And we will not excuse your sin, but we will in all manner help you to raise this child, to become an asset to the glory of Christ, to be a member in the church of Jesus, and to rise, as it were, to profoundly impress and change the lives of other girls like you. And so it is, Karenette, as women who may have made a decision that they were at one time filled with shame with, but Jesus ends shame. I know that the premise of Embrace Grace is that there will no longer be shame, but rather you will accept what God has done because, bing, God did it. Hello? And that whatsoever God hath wrought, I shall participate in. Now, the church has been very good at expelling people for a long time. Herod knew the answer. Send the armies of Israel into the city of Bethlehem and the surrounding areas and kill every two-year-old boy and under. If you're a parent this morning, I know that you can't fathom what that would mean to your household. Where was the church? Where were the believers? With the city streets of Jerusalem said to Herod, you will not go another step in taking our children. You see, this is where the church needs to stand today. This is why we stand out in front of Planned Parenthood today. You might say, oh, it's so political. It's not political. It is an act of a righteous church instilling in the minds and hearts of this community that enough is enough. And we are not going to let this occur any longer. We have people in political positions who profess to have great faith in their Roman Catholic Church that also are great proponents for abortion. They are the Herods that have a semblance of religion. They are the Herods that presume their prideful position can be ensured, as it were, by the continuing folly of abortion. And I say this to you this morning in conclusion. I thank my God for Karenette Pregnancy Center. I thank my God for pro-life ministries like our own. I thank my God that he's a God of grace, he's a God of mercy, and he longs for your shame to come to an end this morning. Dear lady, dear fellow, if in fact you made a choice that you were allowed to make, you might even say it was a legal choice. In fact, it would have been. But it's a choice that is a nightmare to your heart every single night. I say to you this morning, the God of grace, the God of mercy, the God who sought out David in his sin, seeks you out this morning. And he says to you, come. Come, because you're weary and you're heavy laden with a burden of choices that you have made. Jesus says to you, come. Come unto me. Come to my throne. Come to my cross. Come to me and I will relieve you. I will set you free. I will forgive you of your sins and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. That's my God. I'm asking you this morning, is that your God? Father, in Jesus' name, there is none like you. We know that. Deep within our hearts is born this sense as we are confounded by the beauty of creation, like Pastor Connor prayed this morning.
We are confounded by the witness of everything that is around us, that there is a God mighty, there is a God glorious, there is a God that loves us and created us in his image and likeness. And as he attended that moment in your mother's womb, when two cells came together, so also he attends every conception, because this is who our God is he not? And it's he that chooses to breathe life or let those cells just pass each other. Oh, Father, I thank you for every soul in this house this morning that gives praise to you because you breathed life into those two cells. You did not pass it by. And that, Father, we praise you that our mothers made the choice to consider the work of God. And so, Father, thank you that this morning, right now, if you have need of confessing your sin of lust or your sin of whatever it is that you think brought about that child, God is greater. God is so merciful. God is so graceful. Would you just before the Lord right now, just speak with your own mouth. No one else needs to hear, but your ear needs to hear that I'm confessing my sins, Father God. I'm confessing the sin of trying to act like God. And I know that you hear me this morning. I know you hear me, Father. Thank you for the blood. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for Jesus that forgives me my sins and cleanses me of all unrighteousness. Oh, you are a God that is good. Tell the Lord he is good. I love you, Lord, because you are good. You are so good to me. And I accept your forgiveness, and I accept the fact that your blood is sufficient to cleanse me of all unrighteousness. I accept it all because I want to walk with you. And I know you want to walk with my child. And thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for all you've given me and will continue to give me. Thank you, God, for CareNet. Thank you, God, for Pro-Life Ministry. Thank you, Jesus, for this church. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. Amen. I tell you what, I want you to be excited about life because life is precious. And we're going to tell the Lord that in these closing hymns. Okay, let's stand. God bless you.